Hello and welcome to The One Show with Matt Baker.
And Alex Shores. Now tonight we're joined by a Cuban singer who sold over 100 million records worldwide. Let's put some of them on. Won't you help me, Dr. B?
It's Gloria Estefan.
Thank you.
Oh. So you were covered in mud for the last
Yeah, you were just saying, the rhythm is going to get you. That's the one thing.
It got me, yeah. I was covered in mud there. That's one of my favourite looks we've done for a video. Oh. Covered my whole head in mud, and I was tribaled out there. I loved it. A lot
Brilliant.
Of fun.
Great.
A lot of blast from the past there.
Well, yeah. I mean, Matt doesn't stop dancing all afternoon, honestly.
I'm a big fan.
Well, we've got a theme tonight of people visiting Britain. So we were looking through some photos of you and the band, and we found this brilliant one. That's just down the road, actually, from here.
I'm wearing my Top of the Pops outfit.
Yeah.
So we were so psyched.
1981, we think that was.
Could be. Yeah. I don't remember. It's all a big blur. But I can tell you this, that when we shot that photo, that you had to fly here under the chance that you would make it into a certain number of the top 10 or top 20.
All right.
And if you didn't make it, one time, one of the songs we made it, which was Dr. B, which was great. Another time, we didn't make it, and we were here 24 hours and back home again.
Oh, no.
That part wasn't so much fun. But then we made it later.
Wow. And so what was your impression of Britain then when you came here for the first time?
Well, I love history, so it's an amazing place to visit, you know, so many things to see. And we're used to the sunshine, so the weather was a little different, but I loved it. It was so exciting for us because we were breaking through for the first time. And one thing was kind of strange to me, that the press here thought I was too nice. I think I had to be mean.
Really?
I had to be mean, but I couldn't be, so.
Yeah, we noticed that you didn't realise how cold it was. If we just go back to that picture, and your bandmate has got this really weird, like, knitted
tank top
on.
Well, I don't know, if you're going to go for a vest...
Everything for fashion.
Yeah.
And the muscles. They wanted to show off the muscles.
Yeah,
sure.
Right.
Now, if you're going to go for a vest in Britain, a wool one is always the best option. So anyway, so we're going to be hearing, Gloria, about your new album.
All right, great.
Very shortly. Looking forward to talking about that.
Now, when Gloria's not making music, she's busy campaigning for the rights of immigrants. Gloria's family fled Cuba 55 years ago to settle in Miami.
Now, Gloria, we were just talking there about your family fleeing from Cuba when Castro came to power.
It was tough. You know, my dad was a police officer, and he was a very good-looking guy, so he was chosen to be in the motorcade for the First Lady. And the night that the president, that Batista, left Cuba, he came home and he told my mom, we're in real trouble. The president just left. And he realized that there was no way that he was going to be able to raise us in freedom there. So he took us out. He took me and my mom to Miami. And then he got a job for $15 a week parking cars, which he thought was 50. He got very confused.
Wow. Oh, really?
But he goes, I got $50. My mom goes, there's a mistake here. But anyway, he went back at the Bay of Pigs invasion and was a political prisoner for 2 years there.
And what was it like for you then growing up in Miami? But were you still within a Cuban community?
Well, I'll tell you this. My mom created like a commune of women that had their husbands in Cuba at Bay of Pigs who all had small children. So they bought a car for $50. I remember it had a hole in the back seat and they would pile all the kids in there together and we'd throw things through the hole and look out the rearview mirror. But they would go together to do the shopping, to kind of support each other through that. And I remember when we first tried to find apartments, even though I was a little baby, I was almost 3 years old, there were signs that said no children, no pets, no Cubans. And it was very tough for my mom.
Wow.
And she found a great place and brought all these women to create a support system for each other.
Mm-hmm. And in Cuba then, they've been banned radio stations from playing your music until last year when the ban was lifted. So how would you feel now then, Gloria? Would you go back there to perform if you were asked to go?
Well, I'll tell you this, the ban really has not been lifted. That's just some things that they say.
Right.
You hear my music now in the hotels and in people's homes more freely because it's really getting harder for the government to clamp down on them. Mm-hmm. But they won't play me in official government stations, so, which is ludicrous because I do not sing political music. I mean, if you play conga backwards, it makes you want to go beat Fidel senseless with a pair of maracas, but that's a subtext that no one really has latched onto through these
years. I'll tell you what, let's play it forwards, actually.
Okay.
So here we go. Do that conga. Shake your body, baby, do that conga. No, you can't control yourself any longer. Feel the rhythm of the music getting stronger. Don't you fight it till you try to do that conga beat. gets you every time. Even your pair of us were just like this.
Why you got ants in your pants?
Stop it. Anyway, sorry.
Now, this next film comes with a bit of a warning because you're about to see Jay Rayner visit a Cuban restaurant and attempt to salsa. We're really sorry.
Uh-oh.
Sorry.
Yeah, here we go. Let's see.
He looks like he enjoyed that. And before you tippy-tappy in with your complaints, that vintage car that Jay was sitting in at the beginning of the film doesn't have seatbelts.
So we couldn't put them on.
Jay's, yeah.
Yeah.
Was it a good night?
It was a fantastic night. It was a fantastic night, and I did dance.
Who knew?
Who knew?
If I would have met that you don't dance. Who knew there was a Cuban restaurant here?
That's fantastic.
I've come here so many times and never ever knew that this was there. That's amazing.
I'm sure they'll be open arms if you want to go along. But anyway, you've been sampling Jay's mojito. How does this compare to yours? Because you said you're a world leader as far as mojitos are concerned.
We crush the leaves at the bottom, and we use simple syrup.
Mm-hmm. So not fresh lime juice, rather, not...
Simple syrup with the sugar, we melt it down so that you don't ever have the sugar bits, and that way you know exactly how much
it's quite sweet.
Why don't we drink mojitos every night?
That's a good question. But anyway, so...
I call this nuclear lemonade. Mm.
So, Gloria, you have seven restaurants, you have two hotels, you've got a cookbook out. Why is food so important to you? And why is food so important to, you know, Cubans living in Miami?
Well, food is part of our culture. And my great-grandfather was chef to two presidents in Cuba. And when my grandmother was 12, it was the Depression, World War I, and she needed to work. She was the second oldest of 12 kids. So he pulled her into work with him in the kitchen in Palacio. And I grew up in the kitchen with my grandma. So it was her dream to have a restaurant, and I wanted to fulfill that dream for her and also promote our culture through food as well as music.
Yeah.
And that's what we've done with our places. Yeah. This is very impressive.
Yes, it is,
lovely,
isn't it?
Stuff.
And food seems to be quite important, Jay, doesn't it, to expats, because it keeps that connection with their
home. It's a way of remembering, isn't it? Once you've left the country, you can still recreate the flavours. And there's no such thing as authentic, really. People talk about authentic. Yeah. The flavours that you remember in the country. Anybody who's eaten Chinese food here and elsewhere around the world will know how different it can be in all the different places. I've eaten Chinese food in Rwanda.
And it was not quite
the same as it was in Chinatown, funnily enough.
But interestingly, you'll sort of get more traditional food.
You get more traditional food. I think back in the home country, they're moving forward and they're thinking forward. Outside the country, they're remembering and they're trying to keep alive all that culture, which is part of what your restaurants are
about. I would, and there's also staples that belong not just to Cuba, for example, to the Caribbean, the rice, the beans, the bananas, they're made in different ways. And in South America, they do the rice and beans, but in Peru, they'll do the rice with lentils.
Yeah.
And in Ecuador, they'll have a different one. Everybody has their own take, but rice is a big part
thing.
Of it.
Staple.
Yes. Yeah. We make brown rice. We're trying to make it
very healthy.
I have the triple C, calorie conscious Cuban,
yeah.
which we will make brown rice and then we'll bake the bananas.
Sounds like a marvellous idea.
So it's not that fried. And
Now, back to the film, Glory. We saw Jay there salsa in.
Yes.
And we thought, I don't know what you think, that he needs a bit of help.
Oh, boy.
I am a 47-year-old man. When I was...
she
is 19 years old.
You're shaking it.
And I think, you know, I didn't know I had hips.
But you've got this sort of fish hands.
I have hands.
You have to use your hands.
So what we've done, anyway, is we've created this sort of salsa cupboard out in the corridor over there.
All expenses been spared.
And, yes. Here we are.
Here we go, look. And open up and see what's inside.
What?
Oh, look at this.
Now, that's Sean and Martha, and they're going to give you a little lesson, and then we'll get you back and see what you've learned.
Can I apologise to the nation now?
Yes, you can.
All right, I'm off.
I think you're going to be fabulous.
That's
you. There you go. Get yourself in the cupboard. There's a good lad.
See, I'm like that woman who fills their rucksack with trinkets and bits and bobs. And you were just saying, Gloria, that you've got a captain's license.
I do indeed.
Well, how did that come about?
Because I'm a boater and I wanted to be safe, and I've taken three different courses, piloting, seamanship, I can plot a chart.
How big? Yes. What's the biggest vessel that you've piloted?
Well, I can pilot pretty much any size vessel, well, not a cruise ship for sure. But my boat is 37 feet. I can do 45 feet, 50 feet. I know it's different here.
Wow, but, that's great.
Gloria would have made a superb Blue Peter presenter look.
Well, I know, this is it. The cooking, the action stuff, the singing, the performance. It's perfect. So let's talk about your new album at The Standards. Now, it's got a very different feel to what people may be expecting.
It does, but the reason I did my ballads is because at the inception of my life, my musical career, or when I started singing when I talked, was this music. My mother was a huge fan.
Yeah.
And even in Cuba, she would listen to Nat King Cole, who visited Cuba many times, performing Sinatra. And this is what I grew up listening to, was the first songs I sang for my parents when I learned to play the guitar. And it's very natural to me. So it's full circle, kind of going back to my roots.
Yeah. Yeah. And you recorded it all with a lovely big orchestra. And here's you, actually, recording Young at Heart, one of the tracks on the album.
Don't you know that it's worth every treasure on earth to be young at heart? For as rich as you are, it's much better by far to be young at heart. Oh. Hi. Thank you. These guys that recorded with me have done music with Ella Fitzgerald. It was her drummer that played with me on here, Count Basie. Played with Sinatra. They're really the real stuff. And we recorded live 4 days in the studio, 4 songs a day.
Wow. Well, if they were so precious then, did you feel the pressure to get them right? I mean, if you were recording them so quickly.
You know what? I don't think there's a way to get them right because they've been done by the greats. All you can get them is yours. And I really dug deep. And I made sure that I picked songs that were very, very personal to me to bring something else to them because they've been done by the best singers in the world.
Yeah. And one was your first dance in your wedding, and that's why you chose it, apparently. And Matt has been practicing all day.
Oh, man.
The Spanish way of saying...
you've stitched me up now. El día que me quiera.
Oh, very nicely done.
Right?
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
Yes. Oh, there's our wedding picture.
Yes.
Where are my eyebrows? I demand to know who took my eyebrows. It was the 70s, what can I tell you? No, you know what? We danced that on our lawn because we weren't going to have a reception. My dad was very ill. We had come from the hospital, visited him in my gown, and they threw us a surprise reception in our home, 200 of our closest friends. And they put on the music, and our song was always by Roberto Carlos, the version, because this is a 1920s tango by the god of Argentina, Carlos Gardel. And I really wanted to do something new that hadn't been done, add another layer to a standard, and I wrote it in English, trying to make it a killer wedding song. And when I sang it in the studio, they had brought my grandbaby to visit because I hadn't seen him in a week, and I was literally holding him while I sang it, and all the words became about him. So talk about full circle, from our wedding song to all about the baby.
Well, the album is out on Monday, and on Thursday, Gloria has a sellout gig performing the standards at the Royal Albert Hall. But recently, we sent Joe Crowley to a very different kind of...
Oh, I'm desperate to go and see that. Brilliant. Thank you, Joe. Great film.
Yeah, I feel kind of strange. I'm the second mojito of the night watching that
film. Calm down, Baker. So earlier on, we sent Jay off to practice his salsa, and we've been joined now by Emilio, Gloria's husband. Nice to see you.
Who will not be dancing.
That was a fun show.
I was telling you, I was so surprised to see a Cuban girl with an English accent. That was very weird for me.
It means me.
Emilio, actually, if you just pee around the corner, we can recreate that wonderful picture of Miami Sound Machine. There we are.
Oh, God. Where's
the top? There we are.
You know, we're going to need a lot more hair and beard.
It was funny. When we came for the first time, they gave us budget for 3 musicians. Have to play conga, keyboard, and piano, everything, you know, on top of the pops.
They work you hard.
But they're off and running, so look at this. What do you think?
Yeah, what's
I am
yeah.
very impressed.
Yeah. I
am very impressed. He's in.
Good lad, Jay. Carry on, but unfortunately, that is almost it for tonight's show. Well done, Jay. A massive thank you to our guests, of course, Gloria Estefan.
Yes.
Lovely to see you. Thank you for your
time. Gloria's album, The Standards, is out on Monday, and we'll be back tomorrow with Stephen Merchant and our brand new Children Need Challenge. We'll see you then.
Nice.
Well done, Jay.